Cam Reddish's first six games of the season have exceeded expectations, and it's largely due to him going back to his roots. Now, I'll get into that later, but first I have to lay out the story so that you can see why I think that the success that he's been having this season, plus the other things that I'm going to mention in this video, further goes on to undermine Lloyd Pierce and his coaching legacy. Right off the bat, Cam Reddish made a positive impact, being picked 10th overall as a rookie. The offense fared worse with him on the bench, having 2.5 points lesser than when he was on the court. And Lloyd Pierce ended up coaching the Hawks that season to a 20-47 record right before COVID broke out. And it was funny because in March of 2020, Pierce had said that the Hawks would end up making the playoffs the next season. And many in the front office were left feeling awkward as it seemed like they didn't think he'd be the coach by then. At this point, his job security was already extremely tenuous as the locker room didn't seem to trust him too much. The relationship between him and Trae Young seemed to have been strained, where he tries to take the tough love approach, but some players, much like Trae Young, weren't so comfortable with that. During the 2020 bubble, even though the Atlanta Hawks themselves weren't invited to join the bubble, Lloyd Pierce was at the forefront of the social justice movement happening in the NBA, and he was a large proponent of initiatives like having people vote in the State Farm Arena, which was the largest voting place during that election in the state of Georgia. But even though many in the front office saw the writing on the wall for Pierce's coaching job, Travis Schlenk and others knew that firing Pierce when he was this heavily involved in the social causes when it was picking up steam during the summer of 2020 was very bad optics, so they held off during that offseason and elected to give him another chance to see what he could do during the next season. Something that made them feel more optimistic was during that summer in 2020, Trae Young and Lloyd Pierce actually had a talk, and it seemed like the relationship was better off now than it was before. Fast forwarding into February of 2021, the season is in full swing and the prior issues were starting to resurface. The relationship between the coach and the star was heading in the wrong direction again. Add that to the fact that you also had a player in Cam Reddish that was also dealing with a Achilles tendon tightness and soreness that saw him being out for 6 straight games. Now during that stretch, the Atlanta Hawks were 14-20 and the unfortunate news had come that Lloyd Pierce was fired from his coaching job in March 2nd of 2021. 6 days later on March 8th, you have Cam Reddish now going through a non-surgical procedure on his Achilles and now begins the rehab process for him to recover from that injury. Now, if you don't know, the Hawks at that point, having a record of 14-20, were in the 11th seed of the East, and they were 2 games shy of the 10th place, and the reason that was important is because that's where they could play in a play-in, which was something that was introduced last season during the bubble. Let's talk a little bit about Coach Pierce's record and how he's respected in the league, because that does matter too. Look, he had an overall record of 63-120. Okay, if you look at the coaching resumes of all the coaches that have played at least 175 games, that is the 11th worst record that a coach has ever had. And of course, that's not so good. And what do you know, it wasn't just Trae Young that had a problem with Coach Pierce's style. You also had Cam Reddish, where The Atlantic in this article says, Cam Reddish was amongst those, sources said, who also had an issue with Pierce's coaching. Sources said Reddish felt like he was being picked on behind the scenes when it came to mistakes the second-year player made. There are a few players on the Hawks roster who feel like Reddish's potential is higher than anyone on the roster, but that Pierce's input was stunting his development. Oof, quite damnful words right there if I say so myself. But despite that, he's built himself a very respectful reputation amongst his peers. Talking about Pierce's leadership involving the social causes he was advocating for, the Jazz's coach Quinn Snyder said, "Talking to my peers, seeing their leadership off court has been inspiring, including Lloyd's leadership with the NBA Coaches Committee." Now, the article from The Atlantic went on to say that San Antonio's Greg Popovich, Dallas's Rick Carlisle, Philadelphia's Doc Rivers, and New Orleans' Stan Van Gundy were amongst those voicing their support for Pierce. He even went on to be in the coaching staff of the Team USA that went on to win the gold medal during that Olympics. Now, Cam Reddish, during his rehab, he had to go back to his roots. He had to go back to his old high school in his hometown, and he met up with his trainers and they instantly knew what was holding him back as a player. One of the first things they've noticed is that Reddish gets in his own way when it comes to trying to be a perfectionist. So the trainers were really trying to teach him about having a short-term memory on the court. Whenever Reddish would miss a shot this offseason, they would yell out stuff like, "So what? Do it again! Shoot, shoot, shoot! Nobody cares, man!" The goal was essentially to get him excited when he gets the ball, where he has the belief that he's a good player and he's not thinking about the people, the doubters, who want to see him fail in the moment. So whilst Cam Reddish was going through his rehab, Nate McMillan, former Pacers coach who's had years and years and years of experience being a coach, was set to take over as the interim head coach. And wow, things went much better under his helm. You had him getting the Hawks to a 41-31 record when the first game that he took over, they were 14-20. He won 27 of the 38 games they had left during that season, and they went from 11th to 5th in the Eastern Conference, okay? That was a big jump, okay? That was a huge jump. So they make the playoffs, and they play the Knicks toward the 4th seed, and they also had a comeback season where they were down in the standings, and they went up high as well. The Hawks ended up beating them in 5 games, and it was convincing. It was very convincing. They were the better team. And then they end up playing the 76ers, and I think we all know how that ended. 7 games. Ben Simmons, yes, the Hawks won against the first place Sixers, and it was a very big win. And they were to face the Bucks in the conference finals, and man, who knew changing the coach was going to also change the culture of the team? This Hawks team was a winning team at that point. They were winning games and they were very confident, and they were also a very young team. And this article here sums up perfectly how McMillan coached his team so that they could win that series against Philly. In it, they wrote, "One of the underrated aspects of Pierce's successor this series has been making things simple for the Hawks, with the youngest team in the conference semifinals, and that can sometimes stagnate on offense. This is a good tactic." And you could see a difference between the Hawks being coached by Pierce and this Hawks team being coached by McMillan, and it showed during Game 6 of the conference finals, where Reddish was feeling much more optimistic as he was recovering from his injury and he was set to play for the first time since being out with that injury. And he played, and boy did he ball out during that last game. Even though they ended up losing the game and ultimately losing the series, Reddish had himself a game, making 6 of his 7 three-pointers, and he looked as confident as he was in high school, and he finished with 21 points to go along with 3 assists, and he was the only Atlanta player to have a positive plus-minus of +4. And after that game, you even had the coach McMillan herself comparing him to Paul George. I mean, that's high praise right there. And the offseason was a chance for Reddish to further better his game, and you could obviously see him being more optimistic for the next season. Here in the article it says, "Reddish believes he'll have more freedom this season to have the ball in his hands a bit more rather than just being a stationary cash and shoot player, which is how he was mainly used under Lloyd Pierce." And that was exactly what happened. In his first 2 seasons, he was averaging 10.7 points a game and 3.8 rebounds on a 37.8% shooting. And when you look at this season, his third year, in his first 6 games, Reddish is averaging 16.2 points a game on a 46.1 field goal percentage, with a 43.3% field goal from deep. And mind you, during the first 2 seasons, he was starting most of the games. And this season, he was mainly coming off the bench, having started no games. And when you compare his production to the rest of the league, no other bench player averaging 25 minutes or less was scoring as many points per game as Reddish was, and that's just impressive in itself. And I know what you guys are going to say, he's not averaging those numbers anymore, okay? I know, he's played 9 games now, and the last 2 games weren't so good. They really did affect the average, where to now he's averaging like, what, 13 points a game? So when you look at the last 2 games in particular, one against Brooklyn and the other one against Utah, which again, those are 2 good teams, you have him playing, what, 18 minutes a game? 13 minutes in the other game? I mean, he's not going to play this little minutes, right? And clearly he was struggling those games, I'll give you that, but I don't think this is going to be the trend going forward. I think Reddish, he's showing himself to be a much improved player on the offensive end, and let's just say it, man, His success is largely due to not only him being able to recover and being able to rehab in his old high school, you can also thank Nate McMillan, who made things easier for him and who gave him more freedom to really play the way he used to play in high school. And this just goes to show again that his success on the court is further undermining Lloyd Pierce and his coaching legacy. I'm telling you guys, man, it's just, you can't deny it, guys.